Hello, and a very warm welcome to you all on behalf of the Serbian City Club, and thank you once again for joining our latest Coffee With event. Before we start, and in case you're not aware, today's event is part of the Serbian Month celebration in the UK. This year we're celebrating 14th Serbian Month, which is quite an achievement already, and we at the Serbian City Club are honoured and proud to be part of this very important tradition. I would urge you to have a look at the full programme, as there are many interesting events on offer, both in person and virtual. And a note that all online events will be recorded and added to the Serbian Month YouTube channel that is available to all to view on repeat. And all events organised by us will also be available as usual on the Serbian City Club YouTube channel. And just a quick reminder, please click on the subscribe and like buttons and let your friends and colleagues know about us to help you and others be up to date with latest interesting interviews we will be bringing your way. And before we start with introductions, I would just like to make you aware that you should feel free to send any questions via a Zoom chat. Today, it is my absolute pleasure and an honour that we are in a position to host Biljana Billie Krstović, writer, educator, meditation teacher and therapist. Biljana hails from Sarajevo and is incredibly multi-talented, but most of all, a really inspirational person. She has a degree in education and a master's degree in religious education. She's also a psychology, philosophy, and ethics teacher. Biljana used to be head of the psychology department and is currently head of social sciences in the girls' school, where she's also teaching psychology. Apart from that, Biljana has learned every art available to her, including, but not exclusive, Hatha yoga, Raja yoga, Kundalini yoga, Qigong and Kyaikido, and has obtained a first Dan black belt in Kyaikido. And on top of all of that, she's also an editor of Bakshi Woman and Family magazine. She has also written a really helpful and timely book called Using Mindfulness to Improve Learning, 40 Meditation Exercises for School and Home, that we will be discussing today. Dear Biljana, welcome once again, and thank you so very much for agreeing to be our guest today.
Thank you for having me.
Great. So by your own account, you grew up in a country where, at the time of your childhood, spirituality and religion were not really commonplace. However, knowledge, or more accurately, education was, in particular, science, math, philosophy, literature, and art, were the main outlets of self-expression. What was your outlet of self-expression, and did you feel that you could fully express yourself? And if not, what did you do?
Right, it's a tricky question, that one. The thing is, I grew up in former Yugoslavia, and it was a very sort of a different place to what you would think of a communist country, generally, I went to Czechoslovakia and had a cultural shock at their sort of arrangement or what was happening there. So we were pretty free, and I grew up in Sarajevo, and it was a very bohemian time. Everybody in Sarajevo did something. There were artists, chess players, scientists. There were a lot of actors, painters. So I spent quite a lot of time reading, doing a lot of yoga, a lot of meditation, and mixing with all the local artists. There were loads. There was a huge number of people in Sarajevo doing arts. It was probably for the best part, really artistic. You could have just sit somewhere and give 10 dinars in those days. It was a sort of a wide Yugoslavian money then, not just in Serbia. And some poet or somewhere will put you into their poem for these 10 dinars. And next time the poetry collection come out, you would would be in it. Your name would be in it, and what you would like would be in it, and a few jokes would be in it. So it was very normal. So I loved that. It was very much me. I absolutely loved it. And I loved that I could read anything. And I kind of did. I'm a compulsive reader, I would say. Compulsive learner even. So that was it, really.
Great. And one of the things that you mentioned in your book, when discussing school environment, because we're again touching and making parallel between the two, and the impact it on children and young people, is about finding happy self and the importance of it in their and our lives. Can you explain what you actually mean by it?
Right. The problem that we have, particularly in Britain, with the British education, for example, is that we are testing children to death. We are constantly testing children. And we have this situation where we are bringing generation upon generation of children that are parroting whatever we taught them in school. I'm not saying it's like that everywhere. I'm saying it's like that in Britain. To an extent, it's like that in Eastern Europe. To an extent, it's like that in America. But here, it's really testing, real competition. And some parents might not be familiar with this, but I spend quite a lot of time doing this, is that when students apply for university in the 21st century, everybody's presuming that these grades are going to be there. And on top of those grades, students have to somehow make sure that they are they could be deciphered and stand out from other people. So if you, for example, have 2,000 people applying for the same course, and they all have the grades that they need, so what is it going to be the next thing on top of that? Well, obviously, it's going to be all these things that we push children to do. Hours of piano, sports, music, drama, whatever else children do outside of school. And we used to think that in the past, it would be the poorest children that had the worst opportunity to have a good mental health. In 21st century, in this country in particular, it's actually not like that. There are both ends of the spectrum. You have, there are children that are really poor and they can't, parents can't feed them. They rely upon food banks, and they suffering because they can't express themselves, because they don't get support that they need. On another side, you have children that whose parents have quite a lot of money and have can afford to give them extra lessons outside of school. So you have children that are constantly doing something, or extra music, extra drama, extra sport, extra this, extra that, extra dance. So these children don't really realize that life is actually about sometimes just doing nothing. And that's exactly what they need. And the problem with that, we constantly, by all of this, we're telling them, you should be this, you should be that, you should be amazing at this, you should be amazing at that. So they don't have any opportunity to stop and think, and what they think, to get in touch on what is inside of themselves, what is their best self? Maslow has come up with this a long time ago. Abraham Maslow and his pyramid of needs is very much about this. It's about self actualization. It's about every human being is living their life to become the best version of themselves, and nobody knows what that is. They are the only people in their lives that can work this one out, and it's not something that they not necessarily know when they're 10, or not even when they're 15, not even when they're 18, when they need to make a decision where they're going to go next and what they're going to do. It is something we are constantly work in progress. So these children are not encouraged to just sometime focus just on themselves, where the school is switched off, the parents are switched off, everybody's switched off. And just to have a little bit of exploration as to who they are, who they might be, and given a freedom to actually not be in a rush to find it. And that is what I mean. We had that as children. I know it sounds awfully old, but really what I mean here is that they're constantly bombarded with something outside of themselves. And then we have this issue that they just go in life and follow things they've been told, but they don't really know what makes them happy. And we don't know what makes them happy. We can only give an opportunity for them to find out. And that is exactly what I mean.
And building on that and thinking of the transition from that kind of childhood into the adulthood, we sometimes believe that we're actually better equipped to deal with life and life challenges that seem unsolvable when we were younger, in particular understanding on the points you were just making, what happiness really is and how to find it. However, I feel that sometimes it could be that it's just our own way trying to avoid searching and facing the real self because we didn't have time to do so early on, as we may not be able to deal with what we find out about ourselves, as sometimes that reality is something we would preferably like to get away from for various reasons. What are the possible consequences of that avoidance, especially once we venture into the adulthood from the childhood?
Well, you kind of partly answered that already, really. If you think about it, the question is, what is it that we are actually trying to run away from? What is it that we're actually trying to switch off from? If we're trying to switch off from something, it means that that something is not right for us. So I think when adulthood comes, it is a result of this, what has happened in childhood. It's a bit like a muscle, if you like. If we are not helping children to train themselves or to let themselves have a time to discover who they are, by the time they grow up, they long lost who they are. They totally forgotten who they are. No wonder we have people in their 30s when they go completely, there is a massive crisis because people have done all these things in their lives and it's got nothing to do with who they are. So they please the parents, they please the environment, please the expectations of the society, but there is absolutely nobody there that it's them. So I think if this is what is breeding this situation when people feel like they need to run away and switch off from the situation, I think having a feeling that somebody needs to run off from their own life, it literally means that's the moment to look at the life. Because I think from what I've seen in the past, and obviously I'm not claiming by any means that I have not made these same mistakes to a certain degree myself, but there are situations where I think if there is a need to switch off and run off, perhaps it's a good moment to switch off and have a good look at what's going on, because that is the beginning of the real journey, where people really going to start to look at where they want to go, who they want to be. And sometimes the hardest thing is stripping off what you don't want to be there, because you build it so carefully over such a long period of time. I'm this person, and normally people just, you know, holding on to that. There's a massive big a tower, if you like, a massive big fortress. Because people, it's really hard and it's really difficult to go back and rethink as who you are. It's probably the hardest thing ever.
And I guess for people like us, and what I mean by us, I mean immigrants who have gone to a different country and had the opportunity to build almost a different identity to maybe who they are, that the trap is further down the line when they actually almost in a fight within themselves, because their true selves has been hidden or pushed away, and they were trying to be that person they were trying to showcase to everyone else, which maybe isn't really who they are.
Well, I suppose there are two sides to this. One is that any person that had an opportunity to start all over again is in a really good place, because obviously then they can start, because something is so ended and so finished, people that run away from the war. It's so destroyed. So it has to be built from the beginning. Sometime this is a positive thing for the personal growth, because people then actually look at the world in different, they haven't got anything to lose. So therefore they are building themselves from scratch, but not as the young vulnerable adults, but as young children, but perhaps as a bit more grown up person who has some ideas what they don't really want, even though if they had it in the past. So there is a good side to that. There is the other side to that, where sometimes the opportunities are obviously not the same when somebody's just suddenly moved to a different country. They might not have the same support. They might not speak the same language. So there are a lot of what it appears to be obstacles. I think this is sometimes not an obstacle. I think this is sometimes a real tool for growth. So learning the new language, understanding the new culture, understanding how laws work somewhere, how people work, how to relate to people, how to be polite. I remember thinking there are just too many pleases and thank you in English when I was learning it properly to speak in England. And now I can't even feel that anymore. So I think there is only one problem, I think, when this happens, is it keeping a different sort of level of identity, the roots. The roots are the tricky point here. Not the opportunity to build some new amazing personality and new amazing life. It is actually keeping what has been left, because that really needs to be there for anything new to grow. Any new plant cannot grow from the roots that have already been there. And that's what this is about.
Yeah, and just now taking slightly step back and going back to some of the points you made early on about the pressures on children, I was really struck in your book about the pressures you were explaining, and like you mentioned briefly early on, that it's not just for children on the kind of lower socioeconomic spectrum, but actually at the other end as well, and the pressures that sometimes parents or carers put on them, almost like reliving through their children's lives something that they couldn't achieve. And that those pressures could have, in certain situations, serious consequences, both mental and physical, on those children in kind of a longer term period. But you also speak, and you've mentioned it again, in relation to children, but I think it's maybe applicable to all ages, to have that space and do nothing at times. And you suggest the one of the tools that people could use is meditation. Can you explain what do you mean by it and how it could be applied in our lives in order to reach that point where we could have space to actually take stock, think, and maybe then move on?
Right. So but what I mean by meditation, meditation is a really wide concept. There are thousands of different meditations out there, and different people find different meditation to be effective in different ways. So the first thing I would say, if anybody can find a meditation that actually suits them, they should try to incorporate that in their daily life. If anybody can do this with their children, perhaps the whole families can do it, then I think that would be a brilliant thing to do, because particularly now we have another issue, that we have an issue of being bombarded with information all the time. We can't really decipher what is reading. If we read off our phones, it's reading. If we read our screen, it's reading. So the fact that we are actually communicating with other people through written word is very different to our socializing. So I think meditation, it's a good way to, there are any meditation that works, and there are lots of them. It's a good way to stop all the activity. So all the activity, meaning for a moment, not talk to people, not socialize, not read, not just have absolutely no expectations, meaning that somebody in meditation if they taught properly and explain how the meditation works, will have no expectations of what's going to happen during that meditation. That's probably the only time in the 24 hours, apart from the sleep time, when a person doesn't have any expectations of what is happening with them. I have to go from A to B, I have to read this, I have to eat that, I have to speak to this person, I have to drive that. That's all expectations. We're expecting to complete some task. In a meditation, we have no expectations. We go in and whatever happens, it's fine. So for the kids, this is children are fabulous at this because they naturally, every teacher will, particularly primary teacher, they will know this very well. Every now and then look around the classroom and there will always going to be a kid staring in space. Yeah, that's what they're doing. It's a natural way of just having a quick brain switch off. And it doesn't mean they're not really there. It just means they have lowered their sensory input. They might be even have been listening to you, might be even taking everything you're saying. But for that moment, they're not looking anywhere. They're not reading anything. They're just somewhere else in the same time taking your voice in consideration. So what I'm trying to say is that give children space and give yourself a space to have time when you don't have to take anything in but yourself. Or even that should be no expectation. I hope that's clear. It's complicated. It's actually much easier to do it than to explain it to a point.
Yeah, it's a very sound advice anyway. For all of us, but the other term that you're using a lot, and it is in the title of your book as well, is mindfulness, which has been recognized as a very important tool and approach to our own general health and well-being, even supported by the NHS. But equally, I think there is a lot of misconception about what the mindfulness really is. What is mindfulness to you, and what will be your advice about how we should approach it and apply it in our daily lives?
Okay, I dedicated an entire chapter to this because I felt that there are so many misconceptions out there that it's really important for people to understand what this thing is. First of all, mindfulness really is a term that has come as a related to the Buddhist practice, and it's to do with ability to experience moment as it happens. So if I pick up these glasses right now, I am actually completely aware that I'm picking these glasses. I'm not thinking what I've eaten yesterday for lunch. I'm not thinking about what's going to happen tomorrow. I'm not considering I'm not worried about something's happening, that something that's happened 2 days ago. I'm literally just experiencing this moment picking these glasses up, or I'm just experiencing this moment right now talking to you. Well, that sounds harder than when I say it. And that's what mindfulness is. Now, achieving mindfulness is not something that we can do in 15 minutes. It's not something, it's like saying I could become Olympic athlete in 10 minutes. That's just not gonna happen. And mindfulness is state of being. It's state of being, it's state of mind, it's state of awareness, it's state of consciousness, it's state of experiencing life. So there are many tools to achieve that over time, but mindfulness itself, it's not something you sit down in the room and do. That's what many people say, let's do some mindfulness. You can't do some mindfulness. Just as you can't do some fitness, you can do some exercises to become fit. And this is exactly what this is. So there's got to be some kind of practice in a daily life, whether it's meditation or some kind of people do mindfulness eating, which is harder as it sounds, that sounds like, you know, just making sure you are aware of every bite that you've just taken. But the most important thing, there are mechanisms in our consciousness and our mind that can bring that sensation of experiencing reality as it happens. It all kind of slows down a bit. Everything slows down. And then we start to be aware of everything. Buddhists describe things about walking down the road and seeing every flower and seeing every drop of rain, all this. Well, that doesn't really come from anything else but your awareness. And awareness only comes through the slowing down experience of reality. If you've got a constantly racing thoughts going through your head, everything's going to have to happen too fast. Your awareness cannot take all the beautiful flowers as you're passing down the park. You're going to be thinking about what something else that's going on in your mind. And that is what not mindfulness is, obviously. So the mindfulness is state of mind that is achieved through conscious effort over a period of time by an individual. And every individual has a different experience of mindful existence, and they achieve different levels of mindfulness existence and in different times. So we're all different. We all start from a different place. So there is A, no competition. B, is not going to happen overnight. And C, there are techniques that you can do, and they can put you quite into the mindfulness state of being quite quickly, but then it wears off. So you need to keep doing it. I've been teaching my own technique that does this, but it's in my work there instantly, but give it until the evening when the children have, I don't know, homework to complete, and it's too much homework and not enough time. A woman has to go home or man has to go home and make a dinner, check the homework, do whatever, do the washing, prepare something for tomorrow. All of this is a pile up on our attention. So that's where we lose mindful existence, because we're not aware of everything we're doing at any given time. But there is one thing that there is a value to mindfulness, is that you actually do tend to enjoy your life more if you are present in the moment, because you are having more opportunities in your life to enjoy things. Just taking your shoes off, bare feet on the grass, and just sitting in the garden, just taking a moment to just sit there, suddenly you realize what you've been missing, and that's what this is about. It's not something we can really talk people into. It's something people need to experience. But that's what it is.
Yes, and kind of looking at my own environment and people around me, it feels that people are more aware of mindfulness these days. But I have a feeling that it's primarily in the workplace. There are a lot of sessions that you would be able to go to, or you're encouraged to follow, so to help yourself. But and you have slightly touched upon it, we don't necessarily apply it in our day-to-day life, and we feel, okay, I've done it at work, I've had 5 minutes or 10 minutes of mindfulness, or even half an hour, that's great, and now I'm gone back into the really stressful situation of meetings. But then when I finish work, I feel, oh yeah, this is, you know, great, I have now left the stress behind, not realizing that the life can be at times stressful on the points that you were making. You know, are you rushing home to pick up the kids from school or make dinner or do something else? But the benefits of taking this more seriously, and you have mentioned a few bits now, it is also something that could help us reduce depression, anxiety, even stress. And it is recently recommended by National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, which is what I mean by NHS is fully behind the process. But you have slightly mentioned some of the main benefits of this approach for children and the adults. Is there anything else that we can do or should do on a day-to-day basis to be more aware and be more in the moment? Are there any techniques that you could provide or suggest so that people understand what that means, so that they can build it maybe every day more and more? Because somebody will say, but my day is crazy, I've got shifts, I don't have time to apply these things the way you are suggesting. But perhaps there is something that where we're missing a trick, that it could start slowly and actually we can see the real benefits.
Right. Well, you touched upon a few things there. I think if you ask me, I think that we need the entire overhaul and complete sort of change of how we approach breaks anywhere, whether we approach breaks at school, breaks at university, breaks at work. And I think we need a complete overhaul as how we address individual and a community. I think there are several things that you mentioned that have a massive impact on how anybody feels and how we should do things. So really, ideally, what would happen, in people have a lunch breaks, but really that should be some kind of a provision at work or at school or where people gather to do things together, where there should be opportunity for people to take time mentally out of the whole place and all the activity. And ideally, we have, for example, counselors at school sometimes, but that's talking things through. Or just, you mentioned depression, you mentioned anxiety. Anxiety is a bit of a plague in 21st century. And 9 out of 10 people that I work outside as a therapist have issues with anxiety. Anxiety seems to be the number one thing in 21st. It's a thing in 21st century. And anxiety really comes from this very thing, not living in a moment. It's because a person is anxious because there's something on their mind that making them anxious, or they're depressed, they have a low mood because they view on themselves or the world and the future is bad. So something has caused this. Whatever has caused this has not been addressed, and therefore the anxiety is running, the bad mood is running, the low mood is running. So if we were able to learn how to observe ourselves, see what is happening to us at any given time, and then be able to take that out of our consciousness and replace it with something else, then we wouldn't have this problem. Because what would happen? So if we can enable people to meditate, find and diagnose their emotions, feelings, their thoughts, and everything that's happening to them, and then enable them to reassess that and then change that, we would have generations upon generations of young people and grown-ups being completely self-sufficient for their mental health. There would be no pills, there will be no stress, because what would happen is that people will be able to manage their stress. So people will still get stressed during the day. They'll be still probably screaming and shouting at some point or crying or whatever happens. I'm just trying to get like the highest scale of things. But they would be able to readjust themselves, because there is difference in between normal mental health and mental sort of disorders. Is normal mental health is everybody has ups and downs and bad days and good days and angry days and sad days and happy days. It's all normal. It's when people can't get out of it, that's where the problem is. So if we enable people to be able to find these things that are happening to them, diagnose them, and then remove them and replace them with a sort of a reprogram, self-reprogramming, then we have a solution. So many people are not trained to do that. There are many techniques out there that people can learn just to kind of calm themselves down. But there's anything from transcendental meditation, all sorts of different meditations are out there that people can just pick up and learn. I teach particularly grounding, which is has got quite a quick effect, and a lot of other things relating to this, you know, being able to scan yourself and being able to find where something, because there is a massive big connection between our minds and our bodies, and find where this thing sits and then taking it out and readjusting and replacing something else. But if everything fails, there is always something that people can do. Quick advice. I know this sounds, and it sounds totally silly, but actually this is something that I would quite like to point out. If you don't know anything and you've never in your entire life taken a moment to look at yourself and to meditate, if there is a stress moment, literally you can do this. Look at your feet, both of your feet. count to 10, count to 15, count to 20. By the time you've done that, you're going to start to sober up, because it's all happening up here, or sometimes it's all happening up here, depend. But sometimes just focusing on your feet and counting, just literally physically, you know, looking at your feet, is a good first aid medicine. But you have to realize there is no such thing as a overnight mental health. That doesn't happen. And overnight being in command of your own mental health, on your mind and your body and all this. Really, you've got to work at that as you would work at anything else. But the results are far better than anything else. And also, it puts you in the center of your own life. You are the master of your life. What can get better? So this is what I'm saying. And obviously, there are a lot of people out there doing, also teaching all sorts of fabulous things.
And one of the other areas you highlighted, and you've just mentioned it as well briefly, is grounding, which you are calling in your book the magic ingredient for mindful life and experience of reality. Can you provide a little bit more clarity on this approach and explain the benefits of grounding and being grounded?
Okay, so being grounded is again a state of mind, and it's a quite powerful state of mind. It's incredible state of mind, and when you're grounded, you suddenly discover that you are a very different person and that your life is feeling very different. So what this is about, so I mentioned earlier on 21st century notorious computers everywhere, laptops everywhere, phones everywhere. There is this constant onslaught of information that we are taking in. And we are now expected to use these kind of technology all the time. It seems to become incredibly difficult to do any job without it, unless you're actually working with your hands. And that is making everybody quite, if you like, top heavy, like head heavy, because you're constantly thinking, your mind is constantly engaged. And obviously we have serious issues now. The mobile phones are completely destroyed. I'm not building this up out of proportions. I can tell you that the mobile phones have completely destroyed our children's attention. That they have issues putting these phones away on a daily basis. They have issues with not looking at their phones every 30 seconds. They're finding it difficult now not only not to use their phone, but actually they're finding it difficult not to have them on their person. Putting on their bag is becoming difficult. So their attention is so damaged. Now, please, parents, be alarmed by this. Be alarmed by nothing else, but this be alarmed about, because this is damaging children. And I have seen untold damage by this situation that we're having at the moment. Going back to grounding, our children have no connection with their bodies. They are not in their bodies, they're in their minds, and these minds are not even there. They're constantly flying from one place to another. Their attention is never on one place for a very long time. All of these, I'm afraid, are bad news. What is the grounding? Grounding is exactly opposite of this. Grounding is being connected with your fully in your body and being connected to your feet. So you're not up here, you're down there, connected to your feet. Why do you need to be connected to your feet? It's just this stuff that walks around, and who pays attention to that? Well, actually, they are probably the most important thing for anybody's mental health. When we are born, we don't really have to go to 21st century to alarm this. We have to actually go back into the cave people and beginning of humanity. When we are born, we're born without shoes. If we needed the shoes, they would certainly be there. But we don't need shoes. Why don't we need shoes? We don't need shoes because we really quite are in need of our actual physical connection to the ground, to the actual, like, earth outside of my garden, that thing that you probably can't see. We actually quite need that. And why we need it is because with everything that lives on a planet, animals, plants, everything is in connection with the earth. apart from things that live, like birds, they are quite well versed at living in air. But even there, they land onto something. So grounding is necessary because once we are connected to the earth, and once we're connected to our feet, well, our mind and our bodies together, that's what really coordination of mind and body means. That's why you see the sports people being quite calm, quite together, is because they're deeply into their body, because they're using their body, they are aware of their body. Majority of people in 21st century are not aware of their body. They sit on a chair, they don't move, they just stare at screens, and they have no awareness of what's happening within their body. That's is a big, biggest problem. So what I teach is grounding, and a lot of people out there do the same thing. Martial arts use grounding. You see, I don't know, famous movies, you see a tiny person, a big massive person, big man or a small woman and a big man, or a small man and a big man, and a small person throws about the big person. That's because the small piece person is far more grounded than the big person. So grounding, being grounded means being connected to your feet, and with your feet being connected to the earth, literally the planet. Not this is not a metaphor, I actually mean the planet, the ground. And while you are in that state, you automatically become aware and sober up. It's like sobering up. You become aware of your surroundings. You become completely aware of the moment that you're experiencing. Make an experiment. Have a sunny day. Sit on the grass for 15 minutes. Observe yourself before you go, and then observe yourself after you've been sitting on the grass for 15 minutes. You will see that you're aware, but don't be on your phone, preferably while you're sitting on the grass. You will see that your awareness of yourself, your life, and your surroundings completely change, but also your level of calmness and happiness and satisfaction with that moment also changes. And that means that you grounded yourself. Or we naturally ground ourselves. Earth grounds us. We become grounded just by being on earth. Sadly, the shoes, particularly the high heel shoes, don't help. I wear high heel shoes every day, but I am totally aware of the difference in between having no shoes and wearing the shoes. So that's what it means. Grounding is your mental health. That is what's going to naturally bring it, just like that. That's what it means.
Yeah, a really, really great explanation. Thank you. I wanted to kind of look at the something else that's quite common for us who have left their country of birth. You left Sarajevo in early 90s, which, if I compare it to my own journey, must have been quite challenging, both emotionally and in terms of the integration into the society. And at that time, I'm thinking of early 90s, we specifically for us, people who were born in Yugoslavia, we did not just lose a country. In a way, we lost an identity that we grew up with. And these situations could be labeled as traumas in certain respects, which could lead to some kind of internal imbalance. And if not dealt with, could have significant consequences. In your experiences so far, what techniques did you use or advise people to use to overcome that imbalance?
Right. The issue of moving the country, particularly if you move the country in a really stressful situation, for example, I did that. It was a war in Sarajevo in 92. So I left, literally. It was just like, I left. And moving the country physically to a different geographical point on a planet is a very powerful, has a very powerful effect on how grounded we are and connected to the geography around us. That's a very important element. Then we have a connection to the culture, connection to the language, and connection to the mentality of people around us. This is all a bit disorientating once the person make this transition. Even if they've done it on their own accord, and even if they are very excited, even if they moved because they, you know, that was their dream to move to another country, they always wanted to do it. Regardless of the motivation and behind it, the most important thing is how this person relates first to the land that they have a right to. And this is totally not paid attention to. It's a completely underestimated how we relate to geography that we have a right to. And we normally focus on how do we relate to people that we are connecting with. But no matter how many people you meet, it is irrelevant how many friends you make. It's irrelevant what kind of community you arrive to. You have a responsibility to relate to the geography that you have arrived to, because that is actually very powerful. Many people are aware going back home and just getting out of the plane and just smelling the air, just walking out and walking around the airport, they change. They feel like that a different thing comes out. Is because of geography. You haven't met any people yet. Yes, you're tapping into the consciousness of millions of people around you, but it is the mountains, it is the rivers, it is the fields, it is where you were born. The material stuff that has created you as a blood and flesh is there. And that is very powerful. So the number one thing I would suggest to people to do when they move to a new environment is, apart from trying to sort of join in with the local community and become part of the local community and surround themselves and join in with the customs, with the language, with everything else, join in with the geography. If you're in London and you live close to a very large park, or live next to the River Thames, which I live, Thames is just not far away from here. Make a point of actually going and meeting the river, meeting sit down by the river, just feel it as you would feel the air where you came from, where you would feel the smell of the town you came from. Try to become familiar with that. Make a point of making friends with the geography as you would with the people. I know this sounds crazy, but actually it isn't. You really have to pay attention, because your feet are that incredible, they're like an instrument. They are reading everything that is below them. I've got no other words to use to explain this. If you can imagine that your feet are reading what is underneath your body, and if you can become familiar with what you are, where your roots are, because literally you are psychologically have roots where you grew up. You have a roots where you were born. Those roots might not be there. Energetic roots. They are. We us Eastern Europeans are quite used to things like bioenergy, working with hands, healing, all this stuff, herbal medicine. But this is a bit like that, really. It's a bit like you have energetic, psychological roots planted in a geography that you were born in. And you don't have that in the place where you arrive. Now, that is a problem. Mm-hmm. So you need to consciously make these roots with the place to which you arrive. So grounding techniques, linking to the earth where you're living on. I mean, our ancestors used to do that. Our ancestors, people wouldn't build a house somewhere. There'll be a patch of land and there'll be somebody in a house sleeping on a different patch of the land to see where they slept well. And when they slept well, that's where the house would be built. That's what they knew this. This is not a new knowledge. I'm not inventing the hot water here. This is something that we knew as a nation, as people. We knew this a long time ago, that there is a massive impact of land on humans, on animals, on everything. So that is really important. So because you will never really become fully, I don't know, British, American, Canadian, even if you speak the language, even if you have a lot of local friends, even if you pick up the customs, you know, even if you have two Easters, two Christmases, two whatever in your house, because you've taken everything on board, because you accepted everything, this is the part that needs to happen. Otherwise, you're always going to be between the worlds, a twilight zone. You will never really quite be here or never really quite be there. And this is the problem. And this is not a good place to be, because having no sense of a permanent ground is not settling, because you're not really settled anywhere then. You're not settled here, you're not settled there. And eventually, as I mentioned earlier on, you know, I go over there and have just too many pleases and thank you in my sentences in my own language. Hvala onda, hvala onda. I'm forever saying thank you. And the point is that I would strongly suggest, as you're relating to people and the communities, relate to the nature, to the geography, because you will find out that once you relate to geography, it becomes your town. It becomes your, it gets some characteristics and has some impacts on that moment when you step on a tarmac on an airport. It becomes a bit like that. And you become, the day when you know you've done enough of it and when it worked, you know, when you start going somewhere else and you feel a bit sad to leave it, that's where you know it's worked.
Yeah, and building on that, but from a different angle for immigrants or immigrants like us, term belonging or the sense of belonging can mean many things, which can be quite positive, but at times source of unsettlement, especially if the transition was not smooth, and kind of linking to some of the things you were just mentioning now. And we usually link it to the way we feel about ourselves in the environment and the need to assimilate, which can at times lead to change in our behaviors, fully beliefs, or even attitudes in order to conform to the standards and norms of the surroundings. So that potentially could lead us at times to go against our nature, where on the point we were just making, we're not bringing them together. We kind of trying to be something that we are not, and that could potentially create some additional issues. What would be your advice on how to deal with these kind of situations, but equally increase our sense of belonging wherever we are?
I think there is one thing that's really important, that I think if we have made a decision that who we are is already formed, finished, done, dealt with, then that becomes a problem. If we believe that we are always work in progress and that we always change, build onto what we are and who we are, and explore ourselves through our life and our experiences, then it becomes easier. So I think because we could be more than one person, you could be, in fact, having two different identities, and there is no need for these two identities to be in conflict. So the most important thing is, I presume that having two identities, these identities both have to become part of you, and they clearly they are, otherwise you wouldn't have these two identities. I think the biggest conflict is when you start doing something, as you said, mentioned, doing something against your nature. Now, you shouldn't be doing something against your nature, doesn't matter where you are. That's the thing. I think knowing who you are is far more important than worrying how many identities you have. So I think number one, whatever it is that you're doing that is not in your nature is not good. Doesn't matter where you are. I think the most important thing is that you become where you are, you find where you fit within your own self. So it's because the community is huge. You yourself could be fitting anywhere. So I often have this kind of conversation with the teenagers when they have a situation where they feel they're in a group of people, they don't belong, they have to compromise. And I always give the same example, really. And it applies to all of us, really. It doesn't matter of our age. is I usually say, look, if you're at a party and you're bored, or everybody seems to be having a good time and you're having a terrible time, you're in a wrong party. There is a party somewhere with your people, with people that you fit with, and you should be in that party. So it's time to leave. So what I'm trying to say is that doesn't matter where you are, back home, here, Britain, America, Canada, wherever we are, there is always a place for you. And sometimes it's just a matter of language. For example, we are speaking in English today because obviously this is going to be shown to the English speaking places. And obviously I feel quite comfortable because I wrote a lot in English in this particular topic. I feel quite comfortable speaking in English about this topic. But perhaps if we had a coffee, I'd rather not speak in English. I'd rather speak in Serb language. So Serbian language. So I think it's important to give yourself opportunity to meet up with people who can speak your language, do the grounding and do the familiarize yourself with the environment, but also give all your expressions time to express. So if you, it's no difference with anything else. If you're an artist, paint. But you know, if you write, write. If you your mother tongue is different to English, speak it. Find an opportunity. I think it's all about balance. I think it is having a something like a Serbian City Club is really important because people then come together with the same mentality, same words, same language, same behavior, same expectations. The food that they eat will be the same, and so on. All of this is really important. If you can bring your home to your home. Sometimes people say to me, "Oh, just make me a Bosnian pie. I already feel like I'm at home." Do you see what I mean by this? So I think that's really powerful. I think it's very powerful not to underestimate the simplicity of what we are used to being incorporated in what we are not used to. Because eventually, even what we are not used to becomes what we're used to.
Yeah. I could relate to a lot of what you've just said, and you have provided a lot of advice explained various techniques that we could all use and apply in different settings to keep ourselves calm and grounded, which is very, very important. But how do you keep your inner balance and manage to stay grounded?
Right. Okay. Well, I regularly teach. I teach every Monday and every Wednesday. I teach teenagers on Mondays and teach grown-ups on Wednesdays as a part of my job. So even though it sounds like they are meditating and I'm teaching, in fact, I get a lot out of their own practice because obviously I have to then bring myself to the right place to be able to bring them to the right place, but in fact to be able to help them bring themselves to the right place, because it's them who's doing it, not me. So I get quite a lot of doing that twice a week. I also do at least once a week quite a large cleanup of myself, and I do it in a different I do so many different techniques, but majority of my techniques are based on energy clearing. So I would every week I check my energy levels. I check what is within my energy field and I clean it up. I have a place in my garden that I will always work on myself. So that is really powerful because obviously I'm working with people. I'm always with people. And because of the nature of my job, if you're a psychology teacher, or if you're a philosophy and ethics or RE teacher, people think you're either a priest or a psychologist. I am neither. Nevertheless, people come with all sorts of problems because this is kind of a stereotype in their head. So I tend to get a lot of people of all sorts of ages coming with all sorts of issues. And I always have to check myself to make sure that I haven't taken that home. Because there is quite an exchange, energetical exchange and so on. So I tend to, every single day of my life, there has an element somewhere of some kind of energetic work of some kind of a grounding. And obviously, every now and then I'll think myself, oh my God, I'm not grounded today because I spent, I don't know, I spent 3 hours writing on my computer and that stopped. Or, but I'm very lucky because obviously I work, I teach, and I'm always with people. So it's really, I consider that very lucky. I exchange a lot with people. I have a lot of from people talking to me because young people are really open and they exchange ideas and opinions and so on. So I found that I am, because I'm using my voice and because I'm using my body to work, I found that I'm really quite lucky in that I can keep myself quite strong and quite in my body at all times. But it's not everybody's privilege. You know, most people just nowadays just sit in front of computers. So yes, my life is, I mean, I make essences for people. So I have to often, there's always something going on. So I am never not reminded of looking after myself or looking after other people. It's just my everyday life.
Great. And what are your plans for the future? Do you have any projects that you are currently working on that you would like to share with us?
Oh, funny enough, there are two things I'm working on at the moment. I am actually rewriting a novel that I have written about leaving and going back to the place where you left, where I left. So I'm rewriting a novel called 7 Days in Sarajevo. Actually, thank you. I've spoken to somebody in Belgrade that you put me in contact with, which was quite interesting. And so, yes, I am actually dealing with this very thing that we're talking about today, being in a foreign country, being a foreign person, going back home and feeling a bit foreign now there. So I'm rewriting that novel at the minute, which is a slow process. I'm currently looking to do some research because obviously I teach education. I also teach teachers to meditate, and I'm currently looking at some research relating to the mental health of educators, people that work with young people, from teachers to youth workers, therapists that work with the young people, because I'm really interested in the link in between the learning and mental state of educators, because I don't think that you can separate the two. So there is quite a few things in the pipeline for me at the minute. And obviously, it looks like I might go back to university and do some more education there for myself. That's it. I mean, I could, you know, tell you all day long what my plans are. There's always something. I think that's a part of what I think is good mental health. I think actually, hopefully, that also keeps me going, because I always look forward to something. I always look forward to doing something exciting. So there's quite a few things. Yes, I always got something in plan. It keeps me going. I love it.
I'm really looking forward to reading the novel when it's finally completed and published.
As
it should. Yes. Dear Biljana, once again, thank you so very much for your time. I know you're very busy, it's very evident, but you have really indulged us with a great advice and given us plenty of food for thought. But maybe the most important one to take stock, ground and reprioritize ourselves in our own lives. You and I have done a couple of sessions on grounding as well, and I found it really, really useful and helpful. I know exactly what you were talking about. It's what you were saying, staying in the moment and actually, you know, taking all the clutter that's currently in our heads because of various other distractions in our lives, especially computers, etc. So just want to wish you on behalf of the club and myself personally a lot of success in all your future endeavors, and just wanted to thank everyone who are also supporting the club, and to remind you again to click those famous like and subscribe buttons so that we can reach out to as many people as possible. And just a final reminder that Serbian month is still in full swing, so do go and attend any of the events that you may find interesting. So many thanks and have a good day.
Thank you so much for having me.